press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update.
Thank you very much, Professor Kaushik Basu. It's a real privilege to be sitting on this table in your company, because your own contribution to economic thought and processes are something which need to be written in words of gold. So it's a real pleasure having you with us today. These volumes represent my lifetime work, and those who want to know what I thought in these nearly 62 periods of my life, which are covered in this volume, can have this reference volume as a benchmark for future analysis and appraisal, whether what I did was right or wrong, that history will tell. But for me, the Oxford University Press has done me the honor of publishing these really 6 volumes, and the fact that Rudranshu Mukherjee has handled the work relating to my period as Prime Minister of India is a real privilege, because his critical insights I have always admired as editor of the Telegraph and later on as Chancellor of Ashoka University. He is a remarkable human being. You have asked me this question: what did I find when I moved to Cambridge? I was introduced to Cambridge by one of my teachers in Hoshiarpur, where I studied for my MA, and that was Dr. S.P. Rangnekar. And he encouraged me to think of going to Oxford or Cambridge, but he preferred Cambridge because he was himself a Cambridge man. And so I was tempted to go for studies at Cambridge. I didn't feel any experience any culture shocks, although there were people. I was one of the few Sikhs with a turban on, and people used to ask me the question, why do you wear this turban? But in dealings with my teachers, I had no problems. And in fact, I had, as my teachers, some of the greatest economists of the world: Joan Robinson, Professor Nicholas Kaldor, Sir Dennis Robertson, Piero Serafa. So sitting at their feet was itself a great educational experience. And when I did my TRIPAS, I was the only first of that year. So the Cambridge University awarded me the Renbury Scholarship to do research. But before that, in 1956, I was awarded the Adam Smith Prize by the University of Cambridge. So this was an inducement for me to go ahead with research. But I had a scholarship from Punjab University. The Punjab University, I had a contract that when I come back, the money that the Punjab University had spent on me, either I would have to serve them for 3 years or that money will have to be returned to the university. I came back to India hoping to serve the Punjab University, but at that time, Mr. T.T. Krishnamachari was the finance minister and Mr. H.M. Patel was the principal finance secretary. At that time, Professor Nicholas Kaldor wrote to T.T. Krishnamachari, who was a great friend of Professor Nicholas Kaldor, and Kaldor said, "Krishna, I have a student who is ideally suited for the treasury." But I did not join the Government of India then because the Vice Chancellor of Punjab University said, "Gentlemen, if you want to desert us, you better return all the money that we have spent on you." And I didn't have the money, honestly. So I stayed on in the Punjab University for 3 years. In the meanwhile, Nuffield College elected me to a fellowship. And when I completed my 3 years, I went back to Oxford to do my PhD on export trends and prospects of self-sustained growth, which in those days was one of the first few serious-minded work which explored the dimensions of trade policies as instruments of economic and social development. And there I was examined by Sir John Hicks. Sir John Hicks was impressed with my work and he said, "What are you planning to do?" I said, "I'm going back to India." But he said, "What are you going to do to publish your work?" I said, "I don't know any publishers." And he said, "I am the trustee of Clarendon Press. I will ensure that the Clarendon Press publishes your work." And that's where my first book came out as the book which was produced by the Clarendon Press in 1964. And so I didn't feel any culture shock, but it was a great educational experience. I sat at the feet of some of the greatest economists of the world, and I learned a great deal, both at Cambridge and Oxford. And the purpose of my stay was not to stay away from India. I was always in the mind that my ultimate place is in India, that sooner I get back to our country, the better it would be for my own growth, and I hope that's part of my contribution in a small way to the development of our country. So that's where I came from, a small village in West Punjab where there was no electricity, where there was no secure water supply. There was only a primary school which was also at a distance, and I studied until the fourth class in that school. In the fifth grade, I migrated to Chakwal, which was the tehsil headquarters of Punjab. There, my uncle was posted, and I stayed with him. And in the sixth class, I went to Peshawar, where my father was posted. And from 6th to 10th class, I studied in a school in Peshawar. My examination results for matriculation examination took place in Peshawar. But in the meanwhile, partition came, and the result was that the results of the March 47 matriculation examination were never declared. And therefore, when we migrated to India, I had to repeat the matriculation examination once again in Delhi in 1948. So life has been a great adventure and an enterprise which I relished. I have no regrets. I honestly believe that the country has been enormously kind to me, and this is a debt I will never be able to repay to our great country that India is.
Dr. Singh rarely talks about personal matters, but now that he's done it, I want to push him a little bit more. Was there a culture shock you're going into politics? I mean, you were a scholar. You were in Delhi School of Economics when Delhi School of Economics was really at its prime. And you were also an advisor playing a non-political role. Was there a culture shock going into politics?
Well, there was a culture shock, yes and no. I came to the government in 1971, and I stayed on in the government till 87, when I left the Planning Commission as deputy chairman to go and work with Professor Julius Nyerere as Secretary General of the South-South Commission. I had not been in politics, but I had worked with politicians in all these years. In 71, then I started my career in the Ministry of Foreign Trade. From foreign trade, I moved to finance, and that too also under peculiar circumstances. I worked in the Ministry of Foreign Trade for 1 year. I was not satisfied with the environment that prevailed. There was too little emphasis on serious analytical work and too much of politicking. So I resigned from the ministry. Mr. P. N. Haksar was then the principal secretary to the Prime Minister. He called me and he said, "We are not going to let you go back to Delhi School of Economics. And if whatever your grievance, we will make sure that you are promoted and made chief economic advisor to the government." And there was a vacancy, and therefore I became the chief economic advisor to the government of India in 1972. As chief economic advisor in 72, I came to the Ministry of Finance. And in a short period of time, there was elections in 1971 and 72, state elections. Mr. P. N. Haksar asked me, "What do you think we should be doing?" And there is one paper which is missing in this that I wrote at that time, Victory, What to Do With It. And in that paper that I wrote, I said, the victory of the Congress Party in the elections in 1971 and 72 is a rare occasion to use politics as an instrument of economic and social change. And I outlined this broad strategy. One of the two papers, I believe Jairam Ramesh has been able to dig out, but this basic paper, What to Do with Victory, is somehow not available, and that's not included here. But that was my first big introduction to the world of politics. I worked very closely with Shri Y.B. Chauhan, and through Mr. P. N. Haksar, I had ample opportunities to interact with the then Prime Minister, Srimati Indira Gandhi. People say she was very haughty. My experience of dealing with Indira Ji was, she was always very receptive to new ideas, and particularly technological thought processes, where she herself said that she was not very knowledgeable. She listened to expert advice in depth. In 73, the country was in the midst of a 30% inflation rate, and Mrs. Gandhi in Bangalore made a speech that we need a man who is a great expertise to solve the inflation problem that was hurting the country. And when she came back, there was a cabinet meeting, and she asked me what were my thoughts about the control of inflation. And I said, Madam, my feeling is if we learn to convert good economics into good politics, that would be the first essential thing for controlling inflation. And then Mrs. Gandhi said, what exactly do you mean? She turned to Mr. Pandey, who was the cabinet secretary, and she said, I should work with the cabinet secretary and Professor P. N. Dhar to produce a paper, which I did produce, and the government made use of that paper to outline an inflation control strategy. That's how I made my name with Indraji. She was so impressed, and that's where Mr. P. N. Haksar helped me to make my mark in the Ministry of Finance. I worked very closely with Sri C. Subramaniam, and as finance minister, Mr. C. Subramaniam was a usually unorthodox man. Never before a finance minister at the budget time thought of producing a paper on strategies for rural development. C. Subramaniam said we should do that. In the Ministry of Finance, there was a lot of people who said, no, this is not done, this is not our terrain, but we went ahead, and that paper itself was a very influential paper in outlining new way of thinking about rural and agricultural development. In the 70s, inflation control and the management of the balance of payments in the wake of the first oil crisis were the most important policy issues with which I was deeply involved. And then came the emergency. I was appointed secretary to the Ministry of Finance by Indraji. When the emergency was over, there was pressure on Morarji Bhai that I should be removed because I was too close to Indraji. But Mr. H.M. Patel, who was the finance minister, he remembered the letter that Nicholas Kaldor had written to T.T. Krishnamachari. And he said, no, Prime Minister, I know Manmohan Singh for a long time, and he will be able to work with us without any difficulty. And the result was that I was one of the few secretaries in the government of India who kept his job despite change of government. When Mrs. Gandhi came back, she again called me the day she was making a speech to the nation and showed me a draft. And in that speech, there were some things which I felt were not correct. And one of these was that the Janata government had made a mess of the foreign exchange situation. I pointed out to the Prime Minister that, Madam, you may have other grievances, but the Janata government has left you with a hefty foreign exchange situation. And therefore, she, in her own hand, made corrections in this speech. Such was the greatness of the Prime Minister that she did not discourage free thinking, provided one had no axe to grind. And I had the privilege of working with Indraji, and when she came back, she said, I should go to the Planning Commission. Mr. T.N. Kaul was then close to Indraji. He suggested that I should become the Planning Commission Minister. I was called by Indiraji and I said, Madam, I cannot afford to lose my job because I have no pension. And if you send me to the Planning Commission as minister or as deputy chairman, I will have to resign from the civil service. And that would mean that I would lose pension. So Mrs. Gandhi said, well, so what is the way out? I suggested, perhaps I could go to the Planning Commission as member secretary. And that's where the then cabinet secretary said, no, nothing doing, because the cabinet secretary used to be the principal secretary of the Planning Commission also. And therefore, the then cabinet secretary opposed. But Mrs. Gandhi was so clear in her mind, then she said to the cabinet secretary, well, you are raising issues, but we are not writing the Constitution of India or amending the Constitution. If the rules do not allow, the rules can be amended to make Manmohan Singh as the member secretary. And that's how I became the first member secretary of the Planning Commission. So I have worked with politicians. So when Narasimha Rao ji called me in May or June 91, I was not totally alien to working with the politician. But I was told I was not the first choice of Narasimha Rao ji for the finance minister job. Probably the job was offered to Dr. I.G. Patel, who was a great friend of mine and a great economist. He somehow declined, and therefore Mr. Pianhak, Dr. Alexander, who was advising the Prime Minister, he said I should be approached for the Finance Minister's job. So Dr. Alexander came and saw me. I had just come back from Holland. I was sleeping. So my wife said, I cannot be disturbed. But Dr. Alexander said, well, it's urgent, and therefore he came and told me that this is what the Prime Minister was thinking. I was then the chairman of the University Grants Commission. And the next morning, I went to the office as usual. Narasimha Rao ji was searching for me, and he traced me to the UGC, and he said, where are you? I said, I am in the UGC. He said, hasn't Dr. Alexander mentioned to you what we have for you? I said, I didn't take him very seriously. And Narasimha Rao ji said, no, you go and get dressed up and come for the swearing-in ceremony. So that's how I became the finance minister. So people say I was accidental prime minister. I was also accidental finance minister. And Narasimha Rao ji called me and I met him. I said to him that the country is in great difficulties. It requires hard thinking and very tough decision-making process to get the country out of the crisis that she was in. Narasimha Rao ji said, I don't understand all this, but we will give you a free hand with the understanding that if the things go well, we will all take credit. But if the things go wrong, well, you will be the scapegoat. I said, I accept that, but you will have to back me. And Narasimha Rao ji did back me on every stage. In fact, we changed the rules of the game. Previously, issues like devaluation were never discussed between the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister alone. I told Narasimha Rao ji that if you take this matter to the cabinet, it will never pass the cabinet, because I was aware of the fact that in 1964, when the issue of devaluation came up in the government of India, 3 years were lost in debating whether we should devalue or not. But Narasimha Rao ji was so graceful. He said, we will do away with the cabinet approval. You write a handwritten note and I will endorse it, and that's enough. And that's how things worked out. I still have that handwritten note where Narasimha Rao ji signed, saying we can go ahead with devaluation without going to the cabinet. Now, that was an unusual thing for the Prime Minister, but Narasimha Rao ji backed me. But there were times when he also developed nervousness, and the then President of India, Mr. Venkatraman, was not in favor of devaluing the rupee. And he called me and he said, you are planning to do this, but you are a government which doesn't have a majority, which does not have the support of the majority in parliament, and therefore you should not go this way till you have earned the vote of confidence. I told the President, Mr. President, if you want me to wait till we have sought the vote of confidence, there will be nothing to seek the vote for. In the meanwhile, the foreign exchange reserves had nearly disappeared, and our reserves were no more than 2 weeks due. We couldn't last more than 2 weeks, and therefore I told the President that we have to go ahead. And therefore Narasimha Rao ji allowed me to go ahead. But we devised a strategy that there would be two-stage devaluation. I wanted to test the waters, what would be the country's reaction. So first dose was a mild dose, but second dose was a tougher dose. But some people advised Narasimha Rao ji that this would be bad for the country, and he, in the morning when the second dose was to be implemented, it turned out that Narasimha Rao ji called me and he said, we cannot go ahead with this second step devaluation. I had to instruct the governor of the Reserve Bank, because I couldn't disobey the Prime Minister. And I rang up Dr. Rangarajan, who was the deputy governor in charge of foreign exchange. I told him, the Prime Minister wants that we should not have the second stage devaluation. But Rangarajan told me, whatever you may say, I have shot the bolt, I have already announced the raid. So this was a case of a country being helped even when it didn't want to help itself. So these are all incidents of life, my dealings with politicians. I have enjoyed working with all the important dignitaries. I worked very closely with Morarji Bhai. I worked very closely with Chaudhary Charan Singh, and also later on with Chandrasekhar ji. In fact, Chandrasekhar ji called me from Geneva that I should come back and take over as economic advisor to the Prime Minister. I came back, and for some months I was both the chairman of the University Grants Commission as well as the advisor to the Prime Minister. But there was no serious dialogue in those turbulent times about economic policy making. because the country was in political turmoil, so the reform agenda had to wait till a more stable government came, which happened when Narasimha Rao ji became the Prime Minister, and we were able to implement a reform program which has changed the fortunes of the country. But even there were problems. Although Narasimha Rao ji gave me full support, when it came to the approval of the industrial licensing policy, industrial policy, there was strong opposition in the cabinet. Important members of the cabinet were opposed to it, and Narasimha Rao ji turned to me and said, "What have you to say?" And I started by saying, "Mr. Prime Minister, we are doing nothing new. It is all there in the agenda for the government, written by no less a person than Rajiv Gandhi. So we are implementing what Rajiv Gandhi had always intended if he came back as the Prime Minister." And as we came out, Arjun Singh ji called me and he said, "You seem to have studied our election manifesto much more carefully than we have done." So despite serious objections about the industrial policy, the cabinet approved the draft. Jairam was asked to write what would be useful phraseology. But in parliament, there was serious doubts about wisdom of what we were doing. And when the matter came before the parliamentary committee, Congress Parliamentary Party, there was a very strong opposition. And there were two persons who stood to support me. One was Manishankar Iyer, then the other was Nathuram Mirdaji. Nathuram Mirdaji said, "Gentlemen, you may be opposing this thing, but you will regret it if you do not go the path that Manmohan Singh has suggested." So I am very grateful to Manishankar Iyer for the two-member team that saved the reform process. So life has been a smooth sailing. But there were many hiccups in the path, and some good luck, but a lot of hard work. And as finance minister, I used to meet the gentlemen and ladies of the press regularly. I had very good relations, and by and large, the country swallowed what we had presented as the remedy for the crisis of 91.
Given that 91 really turned out to be a turning point for the economy of a kind that we couldn't have imagined, the lesson here is we need accidental finance ministers to do this kind of a magical turning around that India really did. Dr. Singh, as the last thing, I would like to have you speculate a little bit about India's future. What do you expect? Where are we headed to? Is there, on the economy, are you optimistic? Are you pessimistic? Are we at another juncture where we need major decisions? Just your thoughts.
Well, I have always been reminded of a couplet from Iqbal about the future of our country, which Mr. P. N. Aksar used to narrate to me very often whenever we were in difficulties. And that couplet is something like this: "Mit gaye Misr Yunan aur Roma, lekin kaim hai ab tak namo nishan hamara, kuch baat hai ke hasti mitti nahi hamari, sadiyon raha hai dushman daure zaman hamara." So, despite all the hiccups, hurdles, I have no doubt that India will get its action right, that despite the difficulties that may be on the horizon, this country is destined to be a major powerhouse of the global economy. That's what I had stated in my first budget speech. I said, quoting Victor Hugo, "No power on earth can stop an idea whose time has come." And I said, I suggest to this August House that now is the time, and I believe that there will be, that in no power on earth can stop an idea whose time has come, and the emergence of India as a major global power is one such idea whose time has come. Therefore, I have always believed at a time when India was in very severe crisis that we will overcome, we will prevail, and with determination, I think we convert the crisis of 91 into a great opportunity to reform the economy, and the results are there for everyone to see. There have been several changes of government, but basically the broad thrust of economic policy has not changed in the last 25 years. And the result is that India is one of the few countries for 25 years it has an average growth rate of 6.7 to 7%. We could do more, and we shall do more. I sincerely hope and believe that India is destined to achieve its destiny. That's my belief. It was a belief which sustained me as a bureaucrat, as a finance minister, and as prime minister. And I stand by that India is destined to be a major powerhouse of the global economy.
It's time to, this is drawing to a close, but I do want to tell you from my personal account one little episode with Dr. Singh, which told me about the kind of person he is. Just after I joined government, Oxford University Press was publishing a collection of my earlier writings. In that, there was one particular piece written about Dr. Singh much before he was active in Indian politics, before he was finance minister. He had come to our home in East Delhi and had my mother was there, he may not even remember. And my mother was just taken in by the humility of the person. He was already very distinguished, and the conversation. I had written a newspaper piece just praising him. And at that time, he was not a politician, so one could write very freely. I was in government, I was publishing my collection, and I thought, since I'm in government, working in his government, maybe I should do, I'm publishing his paper, send it to him. It's all full of praise about him. And he's a politician, he's going to say yes immediately, and Oxford University Press will publish it. Few days later, a response came saying that it would be too embarrassing for me if you publish this. So no one has seen that piece of mine, which was an early piece that I had written about him. So on that note, this is a personal note, Dr. Singh, that I feel the country appreciates and will appreciate even more the huge contribution, the absolutely huge contribution that you have made to India. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. But last but not least, I should mention that these volumes have taken this shape because of the tremendous encouragement and support I've received from my three daughters, Daman, Isinder, Amrit. But for their enthusiasm and but for their persistence, I think these volumes would never have been seen the light of the day. People say I was a silent prime minister. I think these volumes speak for themselves, and I don't want to boast about my goals or my achievements as the prime minister, but the events that took place are well described in these volumes, particularly the volume which deals with the Prime Minister speaks, I certainly would like to say that I was not the Prime Minister who was afraid of talking to the press. I met the press regularly, and on every foreign trip that I undertook, I had a press conference on return in the plane or after immediately after landing. So there is a large number of those press conferences whose results are also described. And I remember very vividly in 2005 when I went to Washington, the National Press Club invited me to address. Our officials were nervous that I would not be able to manage the National Press Club, but that was a very successful conference, and that conference, its verbatim record is published in these volumes. That will give you an idea of what I was able to achieve in dealing with ladies and gentlemen of the press.